Thank you for tuning in on my talk, Time Matters, Handling Spatio-Temporal Perfusion Information for Automated TICI Scoring, which I'm giving on behalf of all the authors from the Department of Computational Neuroscience and the Department of Neuroradiology of the University Medical Center Hamburg-Eppendorf. As indicated in the title, the main objective of this work is to automatically determine the TICI score, a medical score used to address the success of a thrombectomy for ischemic strokes. To fully understand the task ahead, one first needs to understand what ischemic strokes are, where they occur, and how the diagnosis and treatment are performed. Ischemic strokes describe a blockage of a blood vessel by a thrombus. This leads to a lack of perfusion distal to the original blockage. Most of the strokes occur in the M1, M2, and T segment of the internal carotid artery, shown in the red rectangle. To visualize and assess the stroke, a digital subtraction angiography, short DSA, is performed, where the obstructed artery is injected with contrast agent, while a time series of X-ray images are recorded. After subtracting the first frame of every other frame, one is left with only a video of the distribution of contrast agent medium enhanced blood in the considered blast vessels. A digital subtraction angiography is usually acquired from a frontal and lateral view. These example videos show a healthy patient where there is no occlusion. On the left is the frontal view, on the right the lateral. Apart from individual manifestations, all the before shown arteries should be perfused. In case of a stroke, the blood flow stops abruptly. These videos show a severe stroke where the occlusion is in the M1 segment. In principle, there are two treatment options, the choice of which highly depends on the initial occurrence time. The first option is a drug-induced leusis, while the second one requires a mechanical recanalization, meaning that a catheter is pushed to the occlusion site and the surgeon tries to remove the thrombus. In the process, the thrombus might be partially disassembled and therefore move further distal, leading to a better but not perfect perfusion. In this work, we focus only on M1 strokes, which are treated with mechanical recanalization. To quantify the process of a mechanical recanalization, the TICI score is introduced. It follows an ordinal nature, starting with 0 for a severe stroke and ending at 3 for a healthy perfusion, with the grades 1, 2A and 2B in between. It more or less defines the success of a recanalization by the amount of reperfusion between original occlusion and the post-interventional status. Due to the harsh borders between neighboring classes, the TICI score has a quite high inter- and intra-observer variability. Since this is the first work on automatic TICI scoring, our first goal was to define a reliable performance baseline for our dataset. Therefore, all frames of a DSA series are projected along the temporal axis, resulting in a 2D image that shows the maximum contrast agent to any time point. To process and classify these images, we used a convolutional neural network, CNN. We utilized the well-known efficient net structure and built a two-arm encoder, where both arms and therefore views are connected before the last convolutional layer. As a loss function, standard cross entropy is used. Besides, we take three different measures into account. First, standard accuracy. Secondly, a sliding window accuracy, where a case is surveyed as correctly when it's within the correct TICI score plus or minus 1. For example, for a case of 2B, TICI scores 3 and TA are counted as correct. And lastly, the Cohen's kappa, which is a measure for observer variability, which is often reported in the literature regarding human performance while TICI scoring. The first approach leads to an accuracy of 52% with a sliding window accuracy of 82% and a Cohen's kappa of 0.41. To take the observer variability and ordinal nature into account, we defined a new loss function. First, the ground truth is no longer one hot encoded, but instead smoothed in a way that the new ground truth vector has entries larger 0 for the neighboring classes. The sum of the ground truth still remains 1. The difference between 1 and the value for the original annotations is called uncertainty. The resulting loss function is a modification of the standard cross entropy, which not only is able to model the uncertainty distribution, but in principle transitions between two neighboring states. This loss function is then combined with the mean squared error loss to integrate the ordinality of the TICI score. This leads to a highly improved sliding window accuracy and Cohen's kappa of 90% and 0.46, respectively, compared to the standard cross entropy loss function. Until now, the temporal aspect of the data has been neglected. To process the DSA time series, we are using a gated recurrent unit consisting of an ignore and forget gate, as well as a classifier and cell state. Since the annotation holds only true after seeing the last frame solely, this one is used to calculate the loss value and update the weights of the network, leading to an accuracy of 61% and a sliding window accuracy of 95% and a Cohen's couple of 0.55. In standard video classification, it is common to assign the ground truth label to every frame of a video. This is not practical for perfusion data, since the perfusion is ever-changing, increasing over time. To conquer this challenge, we developed a simple linear perfusion model based on the following a priori knowledge. The perfusion in the first frame is zero. The perfusion of the last frame corresponds to the annotation. Between two frames, the perfusion must be increasing monotonously. The boundary conditions that must still be determined are: in which frame does the perfusion start or stop, and how can the Tiki score be translated to a continuous perfusion value? As shown on the left, the translation between Tiki score and perfusion is assumed to be linear within a single Tiki class. Also, the Tiki score is now assumed to be continuous. The lower perfusion limit corresponds to the Tiki score minus 0.5 and upper limit to the Tiki score plus 0.5. The original Tiki score is said to be the center value of lower and upper perfusion. The linearity in our perfusion model corresponds to the linear increase over time of the perfusion. The function is clipped to not exceed the perfusion, which corresponds to the final annotation of fall below zero. During training, the model output is fit to the linear model using two arbitrary anchor points. We chose the points closest to 0.15 and 0.85 of the maximum perfusion for each sample. Furthermore, each frame is assigned to a time value. These reach from 0 to 1 and are equally spaced. The actual fitting is a linear transformation where the two parameters are calculated so that the time points and perfusion of the anchors correspond to the points of the perfusion model. The example in the middle shows this procedure for a case with a Tiki score of 2b. The straight blue line shows the linear model, which is clipped at a perfusion value of 0.725. The encircled red points are the two anchors on which the shifting parameters are calculated to fit the model, indicated by the red arrow. On the right, one can see how this linear transformation is then applied to all time points of the sample, as indicated by the blue arrow and white dot. Finally, the model is evaluated for each time point, giving the pseudo-label for each frame in perfusion domain, which is now simply back-transferred to Tiki domain. This pseudo-label is then used for training. In comparison to just using the last frame or a projection, a slightly higher accuracy can be observed, as well as a higher Cohen's couple. Most interestingly, even though using pseudo-labels did not lead to a huge overall improvement, the cases of critical misclassification could be reduced, meaning there are no more mix-ups between healthy or nearly healthy patients and the one with a more serious stroke. After the comparison of the applied methods, still the question remains on how does our algorithm perform against human experts. Overall, our approach led to a Cohen's kappa similar to the one reported by Tang et al. Interestingly, our model is able to better differentiate the classes T3 and 0, but performs worse on the remaining classes. To conclude, we not only defined a benchmark and reached human performance for the difficult task of Tiki scoring, but on the way introduced a novel loss function to incorporate Tiki-specific features like label uncertainty and ordinality, both of which likely occur in different medical datasets as well. We also efficiently handled the problem of time series and boosted our results using a model to generate frame-wise pseudo-labels for every sample. For the future, we try to verify the introduced method on a later dataset and transfer it to other similar medical scores like the Gleason score for prostate cancer classification or Timi score in the case of cardinal perfusion, in order to show the generalizability. On behalf of everyone, I thank you for listening to my talk and am looking forward to the discussion.